So we're going to be propping the building from that cavity lintel there into that corner there. The drawings don't show this, but it shows a nib here of the steel, but I think that's not a very good detail. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take out past this wall. These are slightly thick. These are bigger. They're 120 mil Thermalites. So when we go to the drawing, our steel section is 152. So it's a 6-inch steel section. So yeah, I reckon if I go through there 120 plus the dabs this side, we can lose that steel nib inside, so it's in line with this wall here, so you won't see it. So what I've established so far is I'd worked out how many props I needed from that point there to that point there. A general rule is you don't want to go any more than 900 between each prop, 900 mil. But then I thought to myself, that's not the end of the steel there. The end of the steel is going to be on this big 900 pad footing that I dug, and it's probably going to be about here. So what I've done is I've measured from that far wall to here roughly and divided it by two. So instead of the center of that wall being over there somewhere, is actually the center of the steel is here. I'm going to be using a Genie lift to lift these steels in because I'm on my own. So that's my center line. So I've just drilled the hole through. I've checked the spec on the SLA 10 and it is 800 wide, so I can just stick to my normal 900. So we know that that Genie lift can slot between those two props. So one prop is gonna go here. I'm using needles, which is 95 by 95 mil square section steel that goes through the walls upstairs and sits on the floor, or you pack it up so it's at the right level above the floor to wherever you've notched out, but you'll see what I mean when I get there. I usually like to be on a joist. I don't like putting my needles over this bit, even though it would probably be fine, but I still don't trust it. And at the end of the day, you're in charge of whether this house falls down or not, so we don't want that to happen. So what I'll probably do is where my mark is there, I'll plumb up. It's gonna land here somewhere, so what I'll just do is I'll slightly skew the end of the needle so at least it's under the joist at some point. So that's my first one I'm gonna set out. Then if you look, we're close to the edge, but we're not close enough. So what I think I'm gonna have to do then is, obviously that cavity lintel's in the way, so I think if I chop out at an angle and have another needle going through on the angle so it misses the cavity lintel, but it catches the block on the outside here, right under the corner, which is going to be the vulnerable point, isn't it? So I'll have that going through at an angle. And then that's my next prop. That's pretty much right under a joist, so that's cool. Then if you go 900 this way, it brings us to there, but I'm just going to shimmy that across so it goes directly under that joist. And then 900 then takes us to there, which is quite close to that wall, because in theory, you don't really need one that close to the wall. It can be 900 from there. So what I'm gonna do is move it across so it is directly underneath that joist. So I'm gonna plumb all these lines up now, make sure I know where they are and happy. Then I'm gonna reference them on a piece of paper from that joist there. And I'll just do my measurements across, because that is the floorboard I add up on Friday. And then I just need to mark and tape my dimensions from this joist, and that's my reference line then. So measure each one, label it on a piece of paper so I got the distances, go upstairs and I know exactly where I need to chop my holes out for my needles. I just picked up one of these, so it's a tungsten carbide tip saw blade. I'm only going through Thermalite with it to keep the dust down in the bedroom upstairs, because they're still using that bedroom. Right then, let's crack on. upstairs in my drawing, taking that little bit of floorboard off. So this is the reference joist on the drawing. So I've measured all my figures. So we've got one, that's the center of one of the needles there. That's the center of another needle there. That's the center of another needle there. So the good news is there's only one. It's got to go where that pencil line is there in the cupboard. So that's the only awkward one, really. And it ain't that awkward, is it? I'm allowed to butcher the carcass of this if I want, because he hates these wardrobes. So I've just measured my needles, and they're all 90mm square, apart from one, which is 100. So what I think I might do is just allow myself enough wiggle room, and we'll cut them all at 110 by 110 square pockets. Now I've got to cut out of this Thermalite wall. And when I've done that, I'll drill through one of the corners as straight as I can, and that will give me the outline of where to start cutting on the outside then. And I'm going to try and keep them as in line as possible, because when you put your needles in, I always do them perfectly level, so it'll need packing up off the floor, because the bottom of our needle is the underside of this course of block. And it leaves us then, if that pencil line there, if you can see it, that is the top of our steel, and it allows just enough to get two beds in a brick. So yeah, you do nothing. First three pockets cut out. I'm just going to get a rubble sack now to put this rubbish in. I'm going to go straight outside now and join the dots where I drilled. Tuesday morning today, and I've got to apologise, because yesterday, it's the first bit of something interesting I'm doing, you know, learning how, so you can learn how to, well, if you're brave enough, learn how to take out the entire corner of your house. I was right in the zone, and the camera ran out of battery. I have got my props up, so don't worry, I will run through exactly what I did when I get there. So, I've got my props up on the inside, so basically, when you put your needles through upstairs, you need to support the floor below the needles, which is what I've done there, and then obviously the weight transfers from up there through the joists down to the concrete. What I always do is I screw a timber first. I prop that joist. You want to ensure that this is plumb in this direction and plumb in this direction. Generally, you can do one and then sort of eye down. You see that? They're all nice in line. But if you want to use a level, that's fine. And then obviously this is where the genie is going. Oh, God damn it. Do you know what? I just realized something. Hold on. Oh, God damn it. Look at that. There's my pencil line on the wall. I remembered now. It didn't land on a joist, this one, because we were governed by the spacing for the genie. So straight away, I'm going to have to move that bugger. What I always like to do, just for belt and braces, because at the end of the day, you're responsible for someone's house. Maybe I would, well, I probably would do it on my own house, but I always brace my scaffold bars so that if they do get knocked, it ain't going to move anywhere. And it just stops any swaying, gives it that extra support. So all I use, I managed to get these from a scaffolding firm, I think. They're an Acrow to a swivel head scaffold pole connector, which are really handy. I've got a bag full of them. They weren't that expensive, I don't think. I just went to a scaffolding firm and asked them, and I went and picked them up. And make sure your brace has got to be at least a minimum of 45 degree or higher. Do you know what I mean? So 45, but you can't go lower, otherwise it's not doing anything. So a brace has got to be 45 degrees or more. So I've braced both of these. What I will do though, when I've double checked the plumbness of it all, I will also drill through and put some concrete screws into this slab just for extra stability. And again, if anything knocks it. Can't believe I put that in the wrong place, you tits, Tommy. And then as we go outside, so they're the needles sticking through. They obviously go through into the bedroom. They're about, I don't know, 2 inches off the bedroom floor because I needed to allow for a course of brick because the height of the steel falls in a funny place because it's under the cavity lintel, not under a course of brick. So below that needle, I have got enough room. All of this is getting taken out and I've got enough room then. When I put my steel in, I just need to lay a course of brick and two beds then. I always do a set distance off the wall so that my scaffold bar all runs in line. Boop, 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 boop. That's pretty good, isn't it? Boosh. My biggest concern is this one. This is the one that goes diagonally through because I need to support the corner of the building on the outer skin, but the inner skin is obviously separated with a cavity lintel on. So the inside of this needle is going to share the same prop as this one. And oh, another good thing as well for extra safeness again is to use these. I can't remember where I bought them from, but they're very handy and they just drop into the top of the Acrow, because if you can imagine, if you didn't have that, I'd be worried about them dropping off all the time. So before I had them I used to like clamp them with sash cramps, metal sash cramps from like a joinery shop. So yeah, I've got to brace this and then level up these needles. I just did them tight last night so they didn't fall over. So I've just wound the Acrow up tight so it touches the brickwork. But now, I'll show it you when I do it. I need to level off inside, and then the slate packer is to take up any small gaps after it's level that it's not making contact with the bricks above it, above the needle. Strictly speaking, you are meant to dry pack that with like a dry strong scent sand and cement mix and pack it right in solid, but I have to wait another day for it to go off then, and who's going to wait another day? So I, you know, we've been flipping using slate shims for God knows how many hundreds of years because they've got an extremely, extremely high compression strength, which means they don't compress basically. So they're ideal for packing, but do you know what? The last few jobs I've had, building inspectors don't like that anymore. Apparently, you've got to have steel shims. So, yeah, not allowed to use slate anymore. Can you believe that? Right, so I'm back up in the bedroom now. This is the needle coming through. Obviously, this is the one closest to the internal partition of the garage. I'll show you the process of how I'm going to level this now. So, as you can see, that's not level. Obviously, I can't lift that up because I've wound it up tight out there. So what I'm going to do now is just, so if we lift that and then look at the gap underneath. So I reckon that's about 4 or 5 mil. So for starters, I'll wind him down on the outside 5 mil, which should then allow me to pick this up and end up so that it's tight against the block work under there. So I've wound down the Acrow outside, which should allow me to lift this to where it's level. Bang on. So yeah, all I got to do now is pack that with some slate, and then any gaps between the top of the steel and the underside of the block work in there, it will be touching, but just for like an even loading, so it's not just all on one point of the block, we'll whack some of these in to wedge it dead tight, and then that ain't going nowhere. And then once I've done all of these, we can get smashing, as they say. Right, so now I'm outside up the ladder. I don't know if you can see that. I mean, again, you're cutting through blocks, so inevitably it's not like a joinery, is it? So as you can see, I can see a tiny gap there, but I would still go to the effort of packing some slate pieces in there, because at the end of the day, yeah, it's only a mill, but it's a mill that it could drop potentially and cause cracking further up, and we don't want that. So belt and braces is the best way, especially when you're in charge of someone else's house. Yeah, so I'm going to smash that in now and then work my way along to the end. You know, I'm not suggesting you should go out and try this yourself, but it's not rocket science. So you've got to try it once someday, haven't you? Everyone's got their first time. So all I would say is try, no matter how tempted you are, try to avoid strong boys. I know loads of people use them. I use them, but not in situations like this. If I use strong boys, it would be for a small internal door opening or something like that, or maybe a double door opening at the max, where I'm putting like a, only taking a small section of wall out, up to 2.4 meters perhaps. Because if you look up any structural engineer's views on strong boys, basically all of them say to avoid them like the plague. So that's what I've done when I've been doing jobs, because you have no idea of calculating the load that's on that tiny little thin metal plate. And this is just belt and braces. It's got a wide, it's almost like having a footing in midair, because you've come well off the building, so that's providing loads of lateral restraint and support. So yeah, if I were you, I would always opt for this method. Like I said, in certain situations they're brilliant, strong boys. Like if I'm doing a door, I will just disc a slot above where my lintel is gonna go. And you know, on a small door, you need one in the middle. You can put it on the other side of the wall to what you're working, and it's dead easy. But when it comes to taking out the entire corners of houses, I just doesn't sit right with me. And the other thing is, they always say, oh, the structural engineer will provide the propping method for you, and a method, you know. But you try asking one of them for one of them and see what their answer is. They do not want to know, because they do not want their ass on the chopping block. So unfortunately, builders, it's down to us, really. Right, so I've packed everything with Slate, done my diagonal bracing. Didn't quite have enough length to get this one in as well, but if you think about it, this is probably the strongest point, because, you know, all this side is staying in. It's only this side that's coming out, so I'm not worried about that. It goes straight down into the concrete foot pad that I poured for the underpinning, so yeah, it ain't going nowhere.